Welcome back everyone to the next video in the Density Lab series. Here I want to discuss the other two parts of the Density Lab. We will start with part B, which is titled Densities of Sodas. The idea that we want to explore here is whether density is an extensive or intensive property. As a reminder, an extensive property is a property whose value changes when the mass of the substance changes. So for example, mass, volume, and energy are all extensive properties. An intensive property, on the other hand, is a property whose value stays the same even when the mass of the substance changes. Temperature, concentration, color are all examples of this type of property. To determine whether density is intensive or extensive, you have to calculate the value of density of a substance as you change its mass. In this section, you will use both regular and diet sodas as the substances. You will calculate the density of these substances as you increase its total volume by 5 milliliters at a time. Because the total volume increases, the total mass will also increase, which will help us determine whether density is intensive or extensive. Here I'm showing you two tables where you should fill in your data. The first two columns are used to record the most recent mass and volume as you're adding more of the soda. The orange column is to record the total mass of the soda you have, and the blue column is to record the total volume. Lastly, the yellow column is for the density, which is where you will divide the total mass by the total volume. Let's go through the procedure. First, you need to get enough soda to do the entire experiment, which is about 40 milliliters. Use a medium beaker as your container. Pour the soda into a clean burette and flush out the air bubbles from the tip. Now you're ready to use the burette. Record the initial volume of the soda here, and then get a small glass and measure the mass of that empty glass and record it here. Start by dispensing about 5 milliliters of the soda into the glass. Read the volume on the burette and record it in this space mark new burette reading. Then measure the mass of the glass with the soda in it and record it in the space that's marked combined mass of flask and soda. To get the total mass, take the last mass you have and then subtract it from the mass of the empty flask. To get the total volume, subtract the new burette reading from the initial burette reading. Then use the total values of both of these mass and volume to calculate the density. You will keep repeating steps 5 to 7 with another 5 milliliter of soda. The total mass and volume should increase, and you will use these to calculate the density. Once you have 6 data points, which is about 30 milliliters of soda, you can continue to the next table, which is doing the same steps but using diet soda as the substance. Okay, let's move to part C now, which is about using the density of a metal to determine its identity. Start by getting 2 vials from the instructor bench. One vial contains some metals in it and has a label as shown here, and the other vial should look the same, but then it's empty and it's unlabeled. The first thing to do is to record the ID code on the vial in your lab report here. Now you will go ahead and measure 4 different masses using the unlabeled vial. All the masses would be measured with the cap included. First, just measure the empty mass off the vial and record it where the yellow spot is. And then transfer all the metals from the labeled vial to the unlabeled vial, and then measure and record the mass of the vial containing the metal and record it here. Now, using a wash bottle, add water to the vial that has the metal in it until it's completely full to the top. Then gently snap the cap back on. Some of the water may squirt out of a small hole in the cap. This is okay. You just want to make sure that the water is full to the top. Dry the outside of the vial with a paper towel, then record the mass of the vial with the metal and water inside in this spot right here. Lastly, you want to pour out all the water and carefully remove the metal pieces, dry them, and then put them back in its original vial that has the label. Now add water to the empty unlabeled vial until it's full to the top again. Gently put the cap back on, dry the outside of the vial, and then measure the mass of the vial containing just water now and record it here. For the last 2 data rows, you want to first use the thermometer to measure the temperature of the water inside the vial and record it here. This temperature can then be used to determine the density of the water in the vial from a table that's given in your lab procedure. Round the temperature you measure to the nearest value in the table. So for example, if the temperature you measure is 20.4 degrees Celsius, you're going to have to use the density that's marked for 20 degrees Celsius. The next step is to use the data you just obtained in this table to calculate the density of the metal and then to identify which metal you have. out. There are only four possible metals: lead, aluminum, nickel, and zinc. Once you determine which metal you have, you're going to have to calculate the percent error and the accuracy of your measurement by comparing the experimental value of your density to the true value of density you get from your reference source. All right, what I want to do is show you a couple of calculations you'll have to do in this lab. So let's assume that we have the following data from our measurement, and now we're trying to calculate the density of the metal. Note that the measurement you did are really the four shown here, which we can label mass of A, B, C, and D. Now, to get the density of the metal, you're going to need to divide the mass of the metal by its volume. The mass of the metal is easily calculated by subtracting MB from MA, which gives us 60.278 grams using these two numbers right here. The more difficult calculation is the volume of the metal. Now, first thing to remember is that volume is just the amount of space that is occupied, in this particular case, by the metal. So to get that volume, what we need to do is figure out what the total volume of the space is, and then subtract the space that is not occupied by the metal. One way to do this is to subtract the volume of water in D by the volume of water in C. That will give us the volume of the metal. All right, now let's figure out how to get these volumes. The volume of water in D can be calculated by dividing its mass and its density. How do we get the mass of water in D? We just subtract MD minus MA. Dividing that by density gives us this calculated value for volume. Now I bolded the 9 here because that is where significant figure rules tells us we have to stop. But because we're still not done with our calculation, we're not going to round any of our numbers yet. Now let's continue to calculating the volume of water in C. Similarly, that means we need to divide the mass of water in C by its density. The mass of water in C is equal to MC minus MB. Dividing by density gives us this volume, which again has the fourth digit bolded to indicate where the answer should end for significant figure purposes. To get the volume of the metal, we just subtract the two volumes we got to give us this number. Lastly, we divide the mass of the metal by its volume, now in units of cubic centimeter because we're dealing with a solid, and we get 19.32 grams per cubic centimeter. The answer is rounded to four significant figures based on the precision of our instrument. So this next example is very similar in concept to the question you will see in your lab report. So let's say the metal you just obtain or you use in your experiment are pounded to the shape of a wire. The question is, if the diameter of the wire is 1.20 millimeter, what would be the length of the wire in feet if you have the mass of the metal from your experiment? To answer this question, first understand that a wire is shaped like a cylinder, and the length of the wire corresponds to the height, or h, of the cylinder. To solve for h, we must first know the volume of the cylinder, which remember is equal to pi r squared h, where r is the radius of the circular base of the cylinder. If we know the volume, we can use it to find h. So first, let's get the volume, which we can do by dividing mass of the wire by its density. We have these values from our experimental data, so the volume is going to be 3.120 cubic centimeter. Now we rearrange the volume equation to solve for h, which is just volume over pi r squared. And then there's a couple of operations here that you need to do because what we're given is diameter, not radius. So we have to divide it by 2 to get radius. And then we also need to change the unit because we have centimeter on the top. We want to make sure we have centimeter at the bottom. So once we do that, what we get is this value for the length, or h, in centimeter. We're being asked for the length in feet. So we're going to do one more conversion and get 9.05 feet. In this case, rounded to 3 sig figs based on the precision of the data that we have. All right, to end this video, I'm going to discuss specific safety, waste disposal, and any other experimental notes I might have not included earlier. First is you must have all your personal protective equipment, or PPE. So these are your goggles, lab coat, and closed-toe shoes. If you don't have this, you'll be asked to leave the lab and you will receive zero for the lab. For this specific experiment, the soda you use can be disposed of in the sink. Keep in mind that you don't want to use too much or waste the soda. You really only need about 40 milliliters to flush your burette and make all the six measurements. The other thing you need to do is check out the following equipment from the stockroom: a volumetric pipette and a pump, as well as two burettes. These glasswares must be cleaned, dried, and returned to the stockroom when you're done with the experiment. Okay, this concludes the density lab videos. If you have any questions, we are going to reserve some time during the lab to answer those questions before you perform the experiment.